This is much more than a standard fish tank. A tiny world prepared according to the natural habitats of the creatures you see. In this video, we will create a natural habitat and witness life and death. Welcome to Peace of Nature. For the lovely potential mates, I'll be using a small tank with a capacity of 40 liters, which is 10 gallons. There will be some plants in the tank, so I'm using dirt on the substrate. I took the dirt from my own garden and sifted it. I'm completely covering the soil with river sand. The important part here is to ensure that the soil is well sealed at the bottom. Before setting up the tank, I always sit in front of it and imagine. I basically want to do something like this. I took these branches from the dried grapevine in my garden and peeled off their bark. Since these branches won't sink immediately in water, I'm anchoring them to stones. I use Aquarium Safe super glue to adhere them together. Additionally, I will also put this coconut shell in the tank. First, I'm starting with the coconut cave. These fish love to make nests in such caves. The cave has two entrances, and I've placed the side entrance against the side glass of the aquarium so that I can watch what's happening inside. I'm placing a large piece of driftwood right in the center of the tank. This wood has various indentations and protrusions, which the fish might use as caves. In the next step, I'm randomly placing the branches I had prepared earlier. I also want to add more branch details to give the tank a more natural look. These fish can be very aggressive towards each other during breeding, and the branches will help them protect themselves more comfortably. I'm using a thick layer of fine grain play sand. This type of sand is typically used in children's playgrounds. It's one of the cheapest sands you can find and can also be used in aquariums. It's harmless to water and fish. I'm adding a few pieces of stone I found by the river for detail and completing the design with smaller pieces. The appearance we've created is irregular and random, just like in nature. Our tank will be a blackwater setup, and we've reached the most important part. I'm placing dried leaves, walnut and hazelnut shells, and alder cones I found in nature on the tank's bottom. I soaked them in water for a few days, so they will stay at the bottom when I fill the tank with water. All these natural materials will make the water slightly acidic and release tannins into the water. When tannins leach into water, they give it a yellowish to brown tint, often seen in blackwater habitats in nature. This is because tannins dissolve in water and are highly pigmented. Tannins can lower the pH of water, making it more acidic. Many fish and aquatic organisms originate from tannin-rich environments like Amazonian streams and rivers. Introducing tannins into an aquarium helps simulate these natural habitats, providing a more suitable environment for these species. This tank you're looking at is the largest ecosystem I've set up so far and has been thriving for over 7 months. It has developed a food web, and I enjoy watching Daphnia move from the bottom towards the light when I turn it on, becoming food for the fish. I took some water from the bottom of this large tank and added it to my newly set up blackwater tank, ensuring the food web starts from the initial setup. I will use a small filter for this ecosystem. The tank will be illuminated with an LED light purchased from a local company. In the first few days after the tank's water first meets, the color of the water looks like this white. On the second day, the water turned brown, and there's a bit of a cloudy appearance. A week later, the tank reached the clarity and color I desired. Now it's time to plant the tank. In the natural habitat of these fish, we wouldn't typically see very dense vegetation. The plant cover is more sparse. Therefore, I won't fill this tank with plants. Additionally, in such acidic waters, we cannot use any plant we want. If you wish to set up such a tank, please research plants suitable for this environment. In environments where floating plants shade the light intensity increases towards the bottom, so it's more suitable to use plants that require less light. After adding floating plants, the tank is complete. This ecosystem has achieved the look I desired, resembling a small simulation of an Amazonian water puddle. After a certain period, these tiny creatures began to reveal themselves, and their numbers started to increase rapidly day by day. Daphnia, commonly known as water fleas, are small planktonic crustaceans found in freshwater environments such as ponds, lakes, and streams. They have a transparent body which allows for easy observation of internal organs and processes. They have a distinctive body shape with a carapace covering most of their body and use their large branched antennae for swimming. Daphnia play a crucial role in aquatic ecosystems as primary consumers, feeding on algae, bacteria, and detritus. They help control algal populations and are an essential part of the food web, serving as a key food source for fish and other aquatic predators. I want to introduce you to this amazing fish. I've named them Bonnie and Clyde. Their species is Apistogramma cacachuoides, and they are potential mates. As soon as they entered the tank, they started hunting the Daphnia. Apistogramma cacachuoides, commonly known as the cockatoo dwarf cichlid, is a popular freshwater fish in the aquarium trade. They are noted for their vibrant colors and elongated, extended dorsal fin rays resembling a cockatoo's crest, hence the name. Males exhibit brighter colors with shades of orange, red, blue, and yellow. Females are typically less colorful, often displaying more subdued tones of yellow and gray. They are native to South America, specifically in the rivers and streams of the Amazon basin in Peru, Brazil, and Bolivia. They thrive in slow-moving waters with sandy or muddy substrates and plenty of cover from plants and leaf litter. They enjoy well-structured environments that mimic their natural habitat. They are cave spawners, with females laying eggs in hidden locations. Males guard the territory, while females care for the eggs and fry. A few days after the fish entered the tank, they started courting. I was going to prepare a different video for you once we saw their fry. But when everything was going well, one morning I checked the tank, and I found Clyde's lifeless body. The water quality is good. They didn't fight among themselves, and this fish wasn't sick in any way. I don't know what happened that caused Clyde to die. In this life, there is death as much as life. And the death of a living being is very beneficial for the ecosystem. These isopods, which take the dead body, wait to decompose it. As soon as I put down the dead fish, the isopods completely surrounded it and began to decompose it. Isopods help break down dead plant and animal matter, returning nutrients to the soil and making them available for other organisms. This process is essential for nutrient cycling. The fish came into the world for a purpose, lived and died. Even in death, it continues to benefit nature. This is an endless cycle. The human body is the same. There is life and there is death. And between the two, there is beauty and melancholy. As a precaution after this unexplained death, I performed a 50% water change. Bonnie now hunts alone. Unfortunately, she lost her mate before expanding her family. Do you think I should get her a new mate, or should I add a different species of fish to the aquarium? I look forward to your thoughts in the comments. As always, thank you so much for watching this video. Peace and love.